every single aspect of my life has been destroyed. No one understands our condition or the situation we're in. You can't see what's happening to us. You can only see our reaction to it. Everyone's got that level of skepticism about it. People just don't understand, and that leaves you very much on your own. Each time there's something introduced to the environment, which is a contaminant, there's always going to be people that react first. And we're just those people. We are the canaries in the gold mine. I've had EHS now since about 2007.
Electromagnetic hypersensitivity is a condition characterised by a range of symptoms which sufferers attribute to exposure to electromagnetic fields. Common sources include computers, mobile phones and their base stations. In Australia, EHS is not recognised as a medical condition.
EHS people are sensitive to Wi-Fi, smart meters, mobile phones, mobile phone towers, any type of radiation basically. The most common symptoms are nausea, headaches, short-term memory problems. Tinnitus is very big. Like right now, I'm just getting a squealing in my ears.
There is no medical diagnosis for EHS, but the World Health Organization states that electromagnetic fields represent one of the most common and fastest growing environmental influences about which anxiety and speculation is spreading. And as technology advances, our exposure to electromagnetic fields will only increase.
I've been out here about 5 months, I think. I came out here because I had nowhere else to go.
Bruce first felt symptoms in 2007 while living in Melbourne. Shortly after, he moved to his father's farm in Benalla, where exposure to electromagnetic radiation is less severe.
I first experienced problems when I got an iPhone. Was like someone stuck an ice pick in the side of my head. I still didn't click at that time, but then things just gradually got worse, and there was always a correlation between exposure and symptoms. I was pretty much a prisoner in my room for about 2 years. Well, I might be in a pub and everyone's standing around with their phones texting and all that sort of stuff, and I'd start getting a headache, but I was skeptical. I didn't believe it. I thought it was a crock, but the correlation was too direct. You try to explain that to people and they just think you're a lunatic or something, but it's very real. Every aspect of my social life, like relationships, everything destroyed by this. What woman wants to go out with a guy that can't go anywhere? She might as well go out with someone who's a prisoner.
Bruce's computer has protective shielding over the monitor. He says this allows him to work on it most days.
I build content management systems for websites. I do SEO and I do build websites as well. And I do a little bit of graphic work.
Bruce says people with EHS react differently to different types of radiation. But it's inconsistencies such as this that have people sceptical about the condition.
We've been really looking to see whether or not the electromagnetic radiation from mobile phones, for instance, actually causes the symptoms. So far, we've not been able to find an effective electromagnetic radiation on the kind of symptoms that people report from electrohypersensitivity.
Rodney Croft is the director at the Australian Centre for Electromagnetic Bioeffects Research. He's been coordinating studies into radio frequency effects on brain function.
There are some people around the world who are very convinced that this is a real problem.
It's just all closing in. They're just closing every black spot. They're eliminating every piece of refuge in the world where someone can actually find respite. Eventually, there's going to be absolutely nowhere to go.
There is one place people like Bruce can go.
So it is like stepping back in time. You don't have a lot of conveniences, and if you had an iPad, it wouldn't work here. This is the only place in the world I know that is protected.
Greenbank in West Virginia is home to one of the world's largest telescopes. In order for it to operate without interference, use of wireless communication devices is prohibited. It has become a haven for people with electromagnetic hypersensitivity.
It's wonderful because you don't have the electromagnetic radiation emissions from cell towers. You don't have cell phones. You don't have television antennas. It's restricted, so therefore it's a safe place.
Diane Scow has a PhD in industrial technology and biology. She describes herself as electrosensitive. She moved to Greenbank in 2002 after experiencing severe headaches. Both she and her husband Bert believe these were triggered by emissions from a mobile phone tower near her home in Iowa.
It was very upsetting that I had to leave home. I had traveled through Iowa looking for a safe place. I had traveled the adjacent states in Wisconsin and Minnesota. No, I didn't have success. I even traveled as far as North Dakota and Wyoming, California, Oregon, even Florida, many places. And I was looking for absolutely no headache, no pain, no symptoms. But in my searching for a place without the cell phones and cell towers, a park ranger told me about Greenbank.
People who knew me in Iowa and how ill I was there, when they come here, they're amazed at how much better I am. Yeah.
Life in Greenbank is different. A number of people come here and they go through a culture shock. We do not have a Starbucks coffee here. We do not have shopping malls here.
But for EHF sufferers in Greenbank, life is not perfect. Many find themselves isolated from their families.
I feel very isolated, especially when I cannot go to family reunions, when I cannot go to special celebrations.
Diane estimates around 50 people in Greenbank suffer EHS. This is about a third of the population.
I don't want to call it a club, but we have something in common that most other people don't have. We may not have the same symptoms, we may not react to the same thing, but we understand. And that is very important, is to be able to talk to somebody who understands instead of someone saying, well, I don't believe you, you're just making it up. What is difficult is telling someone and they don't believe that. They've never heard about it. If you go to Scandinavia or some other countries, everyone has heard of it.
I applied for asylum in Sweden at one stage because I was absolutely desperate, and I'd been in lockdown for basically 2 years, and I just needed to get out and reclaim my life.
In 2002, Sweden became the first country to formally recognise EHS as a physical impairment.
In Sweden, they get the governmental subsidy because it is recognized, and it will then take care of all the needs of people with this disability.
Neuroscientist Ollie Watson was a major force in the push for electrohypersensitivity to be formally recognized in Sweden. He has long warned about the health impact of exposure to electromagnetic fields.
People with electrohypersensitivity, they do not have a disease. They do not have an overall diagnosis. They are not patients. They are normal, healthy people from that point of view. But in inferior environments, they will function less well.
I knew that, you know, with something like this, it's a waste of time seeking medical help or anything like that. But I did it anyway. And I went to every type of therapy you can imagine. And all of them started from the premise that you've got some psychological problem or you've got an emotional issue.
It is definitely possible that electrohypersensitivity has a streak of or a major impact of psychological factors. So far, it has not been able to prove it in various controlled experiments. There are no evidence that the radiation from electromagnetic sources such as mobile phones, computers, etc., do not harm us. Some people with electrohypersensitivity say that they are kind of the classical canary bird in the coal mine. And it has been that case very many times in human history, that a subgroup reacts first. After some years, it's a realization that everyone is in jeopardy.
In terms of symptoms, in terms of whether people become more stressed with the exposure from a mobile phone, for instance, there's been a lot of this research trying to work out whether there is any difference, and it's a very clear no at this stage.
I've got a good sense of humour, so I have a bit of a laugh about it myself. I don't get precious about it. I understand that they don't know what's going on. Yeah, I miss just having a normal life. I just want my life back. That's it. I just want to do normal things. I want to go to a cafe and have a coffee without coming back home with a thumping headache and having to say to everyone, look, I've got to go because there's a phone tower over there, and they all start laughing, and, you know, because they just don't get it.